of course. I mean, he's again top five. He's up there, right? But again, we cannot correlate. So if we can, then it would have been just the most number of Facebook fans or the most number of Twitter followers would determine an election. But today, it's still not the case.
But the thing is, being on social media is different from actually people talking about you on social media. We were saying a while ago, Prof. I mean, you can be campaigning on it, but the likes of Nancy Bina, you were saying that she used On Ground more in terms of campaigning. And even though she had so much negative publicity online, especially towards the last 3 weeks of the campaign period, she's still on top.
Yeah.
She's number five at this point, I believe, right?
She is.
So do you feel that that also helped a little bit, the fact that, you know, no publicity is really bad publicity?
Well, there's such a thing as an underdog effect. Mm. So whether it's done online or it's done in other media, if you're a subject of bullying or cyberbullying, to be specific,
as regards
social media, may naawa, so it works to her advantage. So it makes sense, at least for the campaign strategists of Nancy Binay, to just make her presence felt by physically shaking hands with the electorate rather than maintaining a big social media presence. Of course, her social media presence is there, but it's not as pervasive or as pronounced as the other candidates who have limited resources, so they have no other choice but to just focus on their social media campaigns.
But the cyberbullying, as you put it, happened in a vacuum. It wasn't other people outside of the 30% penetration didn't really get to see all the nasty things that were put online about her.
Well, not all, but there are some that tend to be picked up by the old media, particularly television. If you look at studies by Pulse Asia through the years, television is still the most pervasive, the most powerful, and the most credible medium. I'm not just saying that because I'm here at ABS-CBN, by the way.
No, it's good. At least we have jobs for a while.
The point here is it's the virality of the social media content that defines the dissemination of that particular information. So instead of old versus new media, what we are seeing is the convergence, not just of the different components of new media, but also of both the old media and the new media. So the convergence factor is, I think, considered by the campaign strategists in this year's elections.
Did the campaign strategists, Lope, you think, insofar as your monitoring is concerned, did campaign strategists make good use of social media? And did it work well for some of their candidates? Didn't work that well for some of them?
I think it differs across different candidates, right? There are some candidates who obviously have a very active social media campaign. So you know that they have an organization behind what's going out in social media talking about these candidates, right? But there's also some candidates who obviously do not focus so much on social media, right? But I think one of the interesting things that came out of this exercise is, in many ways, what's happening in social media still mirrors what's also happening in traditional media in the Philippines. There wasn't really a big discussion, a big event, a big topic that went out in social media that's very different from what people are talking about in social media. Right? So maybe in a few years that might change, but I think based on this past election, there's still a very close relationship between what's happening in social media and traditional media.
And Alexi, you've been monitoring all the tweets and all the posts about all these different candidates, and you must agree with this observation that there are some candidates out there that no matter how you try to present them as social media savvy, that there seems to be some disconnect on the part of marketing. Donald, would you agree with that? That, you know, some just really don't resonate that well, even if they use social media, because there's a disconnect between their personality and new technology.
Yeah, that's why you will see that the younger ones are the ones who are capitalizing it. Mm-hmm. And of course, their circle of friends are the ones really savvy. They're the ones really volunteering. Just to go back to what you said earlier regarding Nancy Binay, or those who have the most number of mentions, Chis Escudero with the Heart Evangelista.
Of course.
They're the ones who use social media as a springboard. Right, so it's not really the number of followers or fans, but really springboard for conversations. So I think when you talk about Nancy Binay, for example, they can use that in Inaapi Ako sa Facebook as a story, and that's enough. to convince the masa, okay, we have to rise up against na mga nang-aapi sa'yo. Right? That's enough to tell the story. You don't have to be too overexposed anyway. Right? The same with the Cheese Escudero story, that inaapi ako ng magulang and so many other things. And that's why, again, you craft a fairy tale and people begin to sympathize with you. Right? So again, it's really storytelling. It is really looking at the sentiments and how do you capitalize on each of the sentiments being talked about you and use it to your full advantage.
So pretty much the same as traditional media, Professor. You really just have to be wise in spinning and using it to your advantage.
Definitely, because the unintelligent use of social media could backfire. For example, I know of several candidates who have decided to use sponsored posts through Facebook and through Twitter, and this tend to backfire because people know that, oh, it's on top.
Binayaran to.
It's on top because binayaran or it was paid for. So if you're not creative with the content, or if you hire social media experts to take care of your own accounts and their writing styles and the way they communicate with the audience is different from yours, then they would see that disconnect. A fine example is the Twitter account of Mayor Alfredo Lim. People know that it's not his Twitter account. He doesn't even have a cell phone. But the writing style of the person or the team that uses the Twitter account starts with O. Because that's his favorite catchphrase.
Yes.
Right? That's his trademark. Mm-hmm. Oh, walang pasok sa Maynila ngayon. So people think that it's Mayor Lim talking. Mm-hmm. And there is a clear disclosure that it's his official Twitter account. The Office of the Vice President of the Philippines also has a clear disclosure that it's not really the Vice President himself handing the Twitter account, but rather his followers. His team or his staff.
Well, there was also a similar story like that with Jambi Madrigal. A few months ago, the Facebook
the
page,
thing, yeah.
yes, they were offering an iPad, and yet she washed her hands off the fact that she was not in charge of her Facebook page. She left it to volunteers.
Yeah.
And when we were asking if they were volunteers from her team or were they just fans of hers, you know, there was no clear answer or explanation to
That would backfire on these candidates, obviously, because people would think that, number one, you're not sincere, and worst of all, you're not media savvy enough or you're not intelligent enough to use new technology. Mm-hmm. So you would turn off a lot of voters, not just the youth.
And yet you still have to do it, though. I'm
of
sure
course.
That you were saying that most, maybe 95 to 98% of the candidates had to use social media as a platform for campaigning. How do you inject honesty into that, though? I mean, that would be pretty difficult if it's really not your thing to do.
But then a lot of the followers would know, right? If you're not, I mean, we both know who's selling the Twitter, who's just pretending. Insofar as their accounts are concerned. Any thoughts on that, Lopez?
Maybe in the recent past, there's been a lot of discussion around the right to reply in media, right? That's a given in social media. Right? You put something
out there.
Uh-huh. Everyone has the right or the capacity to reply to what you put out there.
Right?
So I think in terms of talking about keeping people honest in social media, that's the best way to keep them honest, right? Knowing that people can react to whatever you put out there, and they will speak their mind. And I think as internet penetration increases, as our younger population who are more used to this type of media becomes more mature and becomes a voting age or becomes decision maker, it's only going to become more pervasive.
Do we have anything that would tell us if the same social media savviness, if there's such a thing, was used in local races, or it just ended and stayed at the national level? Anything on that? Well, would it be wise for a local candidate to even use that?
Well, it depends on the area that you're in. For urban areas that have relatively higher penetration rate, I understand that in Manila, for example, both the camps of Lim and Estrada used social media in their campaigns. Actually, even Estrada went one step further to, you know, go full blast, not only in terms of campaigning in social media, but even on national television. I can tell you, Carmina and Lexi, that I was in Bicol these past few weeks, and I was surprised that even in Bicol, you get political advertisements about Erap Estrada, about what he will do in Manila once he's elected. So that's how multi-pronged the approach has become for the different candidates, at least at the local level, those particularly those who are living in urban areas. But if you are in the countryside, and most especially if part of your constituency would include mountainous areas where even electricity would be hard to come by, then of course social media would be an impractical tool for campaigning. You can still use it, but you have to go to the people themselves to really campaign harder.
But looking forward though to 2016, let's say, a lot of them have put up their social media sites now, because sometimes they sort of disappear when it's not campaign period. And yet some of them keep it all throughout, so maybe that also adds to the honesty factor, because they're the ones who are doing it themselves, they are the ones who are, you know, saying the messages, and they're always around. Yeah. So it doesn't feel like they've disappeared and then, ay, porket kakampanya na, bumabalik sa mga social media sites. So do you feel that, you know, it might change in 2016, that it might have a greater impact, social media? So do you feel that they have to stick to their social media sites at this point and keep it going until 2016 if, you know, some of them plan to be reelected or just to keep their faces online?
Well, for example, if you understand like Facebook or Twitter, or specifically Facebook, that's how the... it has the biggest following. If they like your page, and if you do not communicate, the next time you post after 3 years, your post will not appear even if you have 1 million Facebook fans, right? So that's the algorithm of Facebook. So that is why it's important for you to engage, you know, to have a constant engagement with all your followers. At the same time, I think from a local standpoint, I think it's a very good medium in, like what Prof said, in the urban areas. The thing is, they're using Facebook for billboard, more like a billboard advertising.
Right,
they just show their face. For me, I mean, use mass media for that. I always tell, I mean, my students, my, you know, a lot of people, that when you use Facebook, when you use Twitter, social media, it's really for engagement. It's really good for close combat, right?
They want to know you.
It's not there for to announce what you want to do and all of these things.
Are you saying it should replace the handshake?
Not to replace the handshake. The handshake for me is still the you know, the best way. But you cannot have a handshake with everyone, right? So that's why I think it's a good, you know, it's a good backup, that if you cannot shake hands with everyone, it's good to show your sincerity, your intentions through social media.
We were talking about this in the run-up to the elections, Professor Arao, and you were saying, don't just copy and paste.
Yes.
Don't just scan your campaign materials and post them on your Facebook page.
Yeah.
It's a very different tact that you're supposed to employ here.
Yeah, because a status update, while the number of characters or words are unlimited now, you have to make your message as short and as sweet as possible. And aside from posting, you must do commenting. You cannot just simply erase comments that are negative to you. You have to engage your audience, as he said. So both those who are supporting you and those who may be indifferent toward you. So there has to be a polite way of debating with your constituents through social media. And we have to remember that social media, the interface of various social media sites are changing. For example, we've experienced on Facebook the change in the interface in just a matter of 2 years. Facebook was different from what it is right. Facebook is different then from what it is right now.
Sure.
So you have to always study the so-called social media terrain and see how it can best work for you. In other words, just because there's a social media site like YouTube, if you're not that into video editing or video creation, then you cannot use YouTube. But if you're into photo sharing and you want to take pictures of a lot of things that you do, then by all means, go for Flickr, Instagram, and all that.
Okay. Now, Lope, as the professor said, I mean, there's 3 years away still, but already everybody's been saying across the board that this really is about 2016. How do you think this will evolve, the use of social media will evolve, so that candidates can run a successful social media campaign come 2016?
Well, I think hopefully some of the work that ABS-CBN has done in this election, for example, will raise the profile of social media in the area of politics, right? Everyone sort of looks at the Obama campaign in the US as an example of how social media is successful in running a presidential campaign, targeting specific audiences that you want to reach out with your messages. Right? Mm-hmm. So 2016 being a presidential election, Obama being a presidential candidate, I think the use of social media will only increase one election after the other. Right? I think this is part of the reason why, as IBM, we've also embarked on raising the awareness in the Philippines.
Okay, I'm sorry, gentlemen, with your indulgence, we're going to go to the COMELEC now. We're going to go to its headquarters. RG Cruz is there. He's going to give us an update. RG, good afternoon. Go ahead.
Good afternoon, Carmina. Right now, the National Board of Canvassers is canvassing or has canvassed the certificates of canvass from six areas. These are from Romblon, Dinagar Islands, Parañaque, Guimaras, Mandaluyong, and Iligan City. That accounts for about 1.99% of the total votes that the NBOC expects to canvass for the positions of senator and party list. So far, the actual votes that they have canvassed are 719,914 votes. The total number of registered voters for the Halalan 2013 is 52,695,140 votes. The number one at this hour with this number of COCs canvassed is Grace Poe, 391,906 votes. Number two, Chis Escudero, 356,704 votes. Number three, Loren Legarda, 349,357 votes. Number four, Alan Peter Cayetano, 342,290 votes. Number five, Sunny Angara, 322,236 votes. Number six, Nancy Binay, 305,019 votes. Number seven, Coco Pimentel, 304,352 votes. Number eight, Bam Aquino, 296,256 votes. Number nine, Sunny Trillanes, 281,637 votes. Number 10 would be JV Ejercito, 277,899 votes. Number 11 would be Cynthia Villar, 263,408 votes. Number 12 would be Richard Gordon, 263,009 votes. Number 13, Gringo Nasan, 242,973 votes. Number 14 would be June Magsaysay, 235,104 votes. And number 15, Miguel Zubiri, 229,517 votes. Let's just explain that there is the NBOC is on a slow start or is off to a slow start because of slow transmissions from the local canvassing boards. This is because of a previous threshold or previous rule of the COMELEC that the CCS of the local canvassing boards won't be able to transmit to the NBOC unless there is a 100% transmission by all the clustered precincts covered by the municipal, city, and provincial boards of canvassers. They relaxed this rule, they left it to the boards of canvassers to decide to proclaim the winners for the local races so long as the margin, so long as the untransmitted results are not enough to alter the final tally. And they also left it to the regional directors to clear the partial transmission of results for senator and party list to the NBOC. That is in Resolution 9700 and 9700A, which were released earlier this afternoon or earlier today. Now, having said or having mentioned all of those resolutions, the COMELEC now expects that more transmissions will be coming in from the local boards of canvassers. The NBOC expects to receive a total of 304 certificates of canvass for senator and party list. That is coming from the local canvassing boards and the overseas absentee voting canvassing boards. Carmina, back to you.
All right, RG Cruz reporting to us from the COMELEC headquarters. Thanks, RG, we appreciate it. Going back to our discussion now here in the studio. Lope, finish your thoughts for us. You were talking about how this will evolve come 2016 because of what we've done here in ABS-CBN. You said we've raised the awareness, raised the level of discussion as well. You're mentioning Obama. Up to now, I still get tweets from the White House about certain issues that he wants to put out there. So you're saying probably that the candidates who just won and who do want to follow on certain campaign promises or issues should still use social media until 2016 or even beyond?
Well, certainly. I think, as mentioned earlier, this is really an engagement tool, right? This is the best way to have that one-on-one conversation with your audience without, of course, having to be face-to-face with that particular audience. So I think this increasing focus on social media and analytics in the future is really one reason why IBM is focused on these types of technology in the hopes of making the Philippines a global center for smarter analytics in the future, because we think that the importance of the use of social media and analytics in different industries, not just media and politics, will only be increasing in the next few years.
Okay, well, speaking of that, Halalan 2013 has that beautiful tracker. Yeah. And the head-to-head, have you seen it?
Yes.
You know, you really pit each senator against each other, and it shows that, you know, it shows how many followers they have on Facebook, how many they have on Twitter, and exactly how many people or how many sentiments are being said about them. I mean, hopefully this will be the new wave for 2016. Do you feel like this is going to be something that we are to look forward to? Because obviously, what is the percentage of people who are media savvy or social media savvy at this point? I mean, very small percentage of the voting population.
But we've gone a long way. I mean, 3 years ago, we're not.
For
I mean, totally.
Yes. Like,
we're not social. I think right now we are very social. Mm-hmm. You put it 3 years after, I think everyone, every candidate or every aspiring candidate should start creating their runway. It doesn't mean na hindi ka tatakbo or you don't have plans, but minsan biglaan.
Yes,
but correct. You should start today that, you know, to create your presence on digital platform. Mm-hmm. Start showing people that you really care about them. Mm-hmm. And I think it also balances everything, because if you don't care, if you're just there for marketing purposes, right, they will find out also.
And we know, right?
Yeah.
We know. Of course, we're immersed in it. We follow these candidates and their tweets. But even, you know, regular social media users, we know what's out there. We know the truth. And, you know, which is kind of weird, you know, when they're saying something that's not true or if they're not being truthful.
Right? I mean, the candidates, though, have a lot of different things that they have to do. So a lot of times they do leave it to their social media teams, and I'm sure that a good percentage has a whole social media team taking care of Facebook, taking care of Twitter. But should they focus on maybe taking care of the personal side of it, perhaps on Twitter? Because I know that some of them really tweet those on their own.
Yeah, there are some candidates and politicians who are hands-on. In other words, they maintain their own Twitter or their own Facebook accounts. Perhaps sometimes they get assistance, but in the main, they do that. One thing we have to remember is the number of Facebook users are increasing. For example, right now, we have 30.4 million Facebook users. But of course, the users do not translate to individual accounts, because sometimes you have one person having multiple accounts, right? So it's not 1:1. But the thing to remember is 77.5% of Facebook users
are
aged.
I'm sorry, Professor. I'm going to have to cut to you again.
Okay.
We're going to go to this live report. Let's give way to this report from our correspondent, RJ Rosalado, about incidents of ballot snatching in Basilan. RJ, you're talking about this yesterday afternoon. Give us the latest, please. Go ahead.
Yes, Mina, the Office of Comelec Basilan reported a failure of election in one of the barangays in Cavite, Basilan. This was after a group of individuals allegedly snatched the official ballots intended for two clustered barangays. The incident was reported in the Provincial Office of Comelec Basilan just last night. There is no cell phone signal in Tumisi municipality. I talked to one of the Board of Election Inspectors in Barangay Mangal, Anita Escorpin, and she said that they were fired upon by a group of armed individuals while transporting the official ballots and ticket machines in the polling center. Because of fear being caught in the crossfire, the BIs left the election equipment in the vehicle and sought for a safer ground. When they got back to the vehicle, the official ballots were already missing. But Escorpin said the security escorts did not abandon the election paraphernalia. That is why she cannot explain clearly as to how the armed individuals were able to snatch the official ballots without firing a single shot against the soldiers. The provincial election supervisor of Basilan, Utug Tago, said he's still waiting for the official report from the election officer of Sumisip. This is the third incident happening to Sumisip municipality on the day of elections. The first two incidents of ballot snatching happened in Barangay Buriburi and Barangay Baywan, where the police officers were quick to respond and were able to recover the official ballots. Meanwhile, the provincial board of candidates in Basilan is still waiting for the election returns from the different municipalities in the province. As of 12 noon today, only 2 out of 14 municipalities were able to transmit their election returns to the PBOC. For ANC, RJ Rosalado, ABS-CBN News.
And thank you, RJ Rosalado. They're reporting to us about the failure of elections being declared in a couple of areas there in Basilan. We'll give you details in our succeeding newscast. In the meantime, back to our discussion here. Lexi?
Okay, well, maybe we can ask for the final words because, you know, moving on to 2016 again, because right now it's finished. The elections are done. But social media is a part of our daily lives at this point. So a lot of the candidates or even people in government cannot deny that. So what exactly do they have to do? We were talking about it a while ago, though, to involve, to engage a lot of their, well, constituents or people who could possibly look up to them in the future. So maybe your final thoughts on what they have to do.
Of course, what's important is to reflect what is in their program in social media. They have to be very, very transparent in their in the way they do things. So it's not just in social media, but in how they disseminate information. So they have to believe that part of the function of social media is engagement with the community, and that you're using it as a tool for information dissemination and not for black propaganda, not for airing personal rants, because sometimes the quarrels in real life would originate from exchanges in social media. A celebrity family, for example, their relationship became more dysfunctional because of a comment on Instagram.
Right.
I think you know what the family I'm talking about.
Yes,
here,
exactly.
Right?
So, and it gets
that's the
escalated.
Problem
and
that
it
we
just,
have right
yes,
now.
Yes, correct.
Yeah, so it gets escalated. So the government officials and those who are running for elections should ensure that they use social media wisely and they use social media responsibly.
Okay, Donald?
Well, I think for government officials who will be running in the future, remember that social media is just one of the marketing tools in your toolkit. You still need broadcast, you still need mass media to really propel you to get awareness, to get your platform across. Again, social media is for engagement, for you to have a direct relationship with them. It has to work both ways, and it is very good for them. It would be very good for them to invest in that right now. So I hope that, you know, some of them would start working on that and really show what their what their costs are, what their advocacies are, as early as now.
Okay, and Lope?
I think for us, it's really looking at social media as a tool, not just for politics, but maybe for government service, mm-hmm. as well as for other industries as well, right? As our people become more tech-savvy, as the younger population matures, I'm sure the use of social media in our society will only increase. So this early, we have to be ready, and we have to be aware of the power of social media and be ready to harness its capabilities.
All right, so it's a lively discussion.
Right, it's all about engagement. All the three gentlemen agree with that. You have them now, don't lose that engagement.
Exactly.
Just keep your hold on your Twitter followers, Facebook followers, and what have you. Well, and those were the latest on the elections this hour. I'm Carmina Constantino. We're going to have to say goodbye.
Yes, of course. And I'm Lexi Schultz. Stay tuned as we'll continue to give you updates on the results of Halalan 2013. Top Story is up next.